Our guest speaker today is the command historian for the U.S. Army Signal Center at Fort Gordon. He's been in that role since 2002. He's a retired Army officer, as many of us are. He's a distinguished historian who has written several articles about the first and second sieges of Augusta. And he's currently writing a book about the sieges of Augusta. We're trying to get him to write a book about the sieges of Augusta. Stephen J. Rauch.
Can everybody hear me okay? Too loud, too soft? Okay, good. So, well, good afternoon. Thank you for attending. And I know it's probably difficult getting back from lunch with all that traffic out there. It's a mess. It's a mess downtown today. But I do appreciate the invitation from Sonny and his crew here in Augusta to commemorate the second Battle of Augusta, second Siege of Augusta. And I've been working on this topic since about 2006 when we did the 225th anniversary. Is anybody here for that? Did anybody participate or see that? Okay, one hand? One? Two? Okay, got it. There we go. It was a big deal back then. And so it's good that we kind of catch these intermediate anniversaries as well, because I know the 250th is going to be coming down the road here in about 10 years. I would ask that if you have any questions about what I talk about, please hold those till the end, because I'm kind of on a roll trying to stay to some time here, and some of it is kind of detailed information. But let me begin. If you go to the next slide, please. So just to give you some context, during the Revolutionary War, and in many wars, different battles are fought over the same terrain, and oftentimes that gets convoluted, and the time frame seems to be lost about when things actually occurred. So in the case of Augusta, there are three distinct campaigns where Augusta plays a role. And the first one that you see there on the slide, the 1779 piece, was right after the British captured Savannah in December of 1778. Archibald Campbell marches north along the Savannah River with his army, and he arrives in Augusta, and there's some skirmishes along the way near Burke County, the Burke County Jail, Spirit Creek, and so forth. And then once he gets to Augusta, he spends about 2 weeks here attempting to recruit Loyalists. Loyalists are on their way to Augusta, as many of you know, and they're intercepted out at Kettle Creek there in Washington and in Wilkes County. The one thing, one correction on the slide there where it says no fortifications, there was the only fortification in town at that time was Fort Grierson, which was really a private house. It was James Grierson's trading complex, so to speak. And that was the only sort of fortification available at the time in February 1779. There was no battle here at that time. On February 14th, the same day as the Battle of Kettle Creek, it just so happened that there was a large Patriot army forming on the other side of the Savannah River, and so Campbell decided to move back towards Savannah, which he did, and Augusta was back under control of the Whigs at that time. The next role that Augusta plays is when the British invade South Carolina and capture Charleston. In the spring of 1780, when those forces there start dispersing into the backcountry, into South Carolina and Georgia, that is when Thomas Brown and his King's Rangers provincial unit arrive in Augusta to take control, and he becomes the commander, the Loyalist commander here at Augusta. Still only Fort Grierson is in existence. He had requested monies and so forth from Cornwallis to build some forts, but he was denied that. And in September of 1780, as you recall from last year's commemoration of the first Battle of Augusta, that was what occurs here in September of 1780. Because Brown had no fortifications, he was kind of open to that attack, And, of course, the Battle of the White House or the McKay Trading Post occurs right here where this building is standing. This building is built on a battlefield. And so that convinces the British that maybe we ought to build some forts and some fortifications in Augusta. And they do. And so they will do that, and I'll describe those here in a moment. But the battle that we're talking about today is often overlooked. And I'm still not quite sure why. It is one of the larger battles, or at least is equal to in size as many of the other ones that are commemorated. And it is part of Greene's liberation campaign that takes place in the spring of 1781. By this time, there is in town, in addition to Fort Grierson, a substantial earthen fort built at the site of St. Paul's Church, known as Fort Cornwallis. And the second siege of Augusta, as it's sometimes referred to, takes place, as you see there on this slide, between May 23rd and June 5th. And the major players on the Patriot side, of course, are Lieutenant Colonel Henry Lee of the Continental Army, General Andrew Pickens, and Colonel Elijah Clark. And once this, this siege is finished, the Whigs will control Augusta again. Next slide, please. Now, just to kind of orient you, particularly those that aren't from here, why is Augusta so important? It is, as Dr. Ed Cashin said some years ago, the key to the Indian country. It is at the place where all the roads come to for trade. And I just kind of refer to this as kind of the Walmart for the Indian nations, right? They show up here when they need something. This is where they come, along the various trails. From the north, the Cherokee country, from the west, the Creek country, and so forth. And this town really made itself on trade because obviously the Savannah River, you can bring things up the Savannah River. This is the fall line, so the Savannah Rapids kind of stop you from going any further north from this point. And so you pretty much have to download all of your supplies off of your boats here. And then at this point, you start trading on land. And so as far as the British go, after the British captured Augusta in 1780, Thomas Brown, one of his jobs that he had, he wore several hats. One of the hats that he wore was as a British Indian agent, and he was to resume trade with the Indian tribes, set up an intelligence network, and attempt to get them to provide aid to the British in all of their endeavors, and he does pretty well at that. The Indians are a bit hesitant; they've been burned many times before, so they're really not all that up for it. But some of them do participate. Next slide, please. Now, that's a little bit of a busy slide, but let me just explain what's going on here. This shows, in kind of a summary, the events that occur in April, May, and June in South Carolina and Georgia. And Greene will move into South Carolina after Cornwallis moves to Virginia. And instead of following Cornwallis, Greene makes the decision to follow or to move into South Carolina and liberate it. There's garrisons of British troops all over the state in various places. As you see on the map, Fort Watson, Fort Mott, Fort Granby, there's a base in Orangeburg, there's a base here in Augusta, a base in 96. And so Greene will enter into South Carolina, and he will then coordinate with the Patriot leaders of the region, such as Francis Marion, Andrew Pickens, Thomas Sumter, and Elijah Clark, and coordinate operations with them. And he will send parts of his army to cooperate with them. So, for example, down towards the coast where you see Marion, Lee and his legion will be sent off to work with Francis Marion, and they will participate in several sieges, the siege of Fort Mott, the siege of Fort Watson first, the siege of Fort Mott, and then eventually Lee will make his way to Fort Granby, where he's actually kind of in competition with Sumter. And so throughout the month of April, these things are taking place. Greene fights the Battle of Hobkirk Hill in Camden. And then after that point, they will. Everyone kind of starts moving to the west once the eastern bases have been captured and reduced. The only two major British bases are Augusta and 96. Now, the British commander in the south that's kind of in charge of everything at this time is Lord Rawdon, Francis Lord Rawdon. He will send a message to John Harris Kruger at 96 to tell him to evacuate 96, give up the post, and move to Augusta and join forces with Brown here, because it'd be more defensible. It's along the Savannah River, and it's just not way out there, out of touch with everything else. That message never gets to Kruger, and so as a result, he stays at 96, which is going to lead to a parallel operation taking place at the same time. So after the siege of Fort Granby, Greene decides to split his army up. He's going to move. He himself will take the main army towards 96 and conduct eventually a siege there. And he will send Light Horse Harry Lee along with some of his troops here to Augusta. And so now this kind of brings us to our story here. On May 16, 1781, Greene orders Henry Lee to Augusta. Now Lee has three troops of cavalry, four companies of light infantry. He has a light infantry battalion of North Carolina regulars under Major Pinkerton Eaton, and one cannon, a six-pound cannon, commanded by Ebenezer Finley. Now his mission, according to Greene, is to join Andrew Pickens and Elijah Clark at Augusta and capture this post. Greene told Lee this, and this is a quote: "Perform the march as soon as you can without injury to your troops, and make vigorous exertions for the reduction of those posts after your arrival. Should the post surrender, you will take special care that none of the stores are plundered," meaning the supplies. On the 21st of May, Greene sends another letter to Lee and says, "Push his operations and cultivate a good understanding with General Pickens and the militia. Should you succeed, take care to preserve the stores if any are taken." So you have to wonder, what's he so concerned about? What's these stores that he keeps writing about? Well, it's supplies. And both teams want them. The militia want them and the Continental Army. And so there's a little bit of competition for the bounty that results when you capture a place. And Greene was concerned about that. But he also wanted to prevent theft and plunder, because these were items of war that needed to be preserved. He was also sensitive to the militia versus Continental perceptions and didn't want that to cause any friction and affect morale. So with those orders, Lee proceeds to the Augusta area, covers 75 miles from Fort Granby, which is Casey, South Carolina today. For those of you that may be familiar with it, it's just on this side of the river up there. He covers 75 miles from Fort Granby in 3 days, and upon hearing of this movement, Greene wrote to Lee on the 22nd of May. He said, "Your early arrival at Augusta astonishes me. For rapid marches, you exceed Lord Cornwallis and everybody else. We performed the march to 96 in as fast a time as we could, but our exertions, when compared with yours, have no merit." So he's very astounded and very appreciative of what Lee is able to do. But then again, Lee's army is very fast. Greene's got all kinds of stuff he's got to carry. Next slide, please. So this map just kind of I use to show the relationships of where things are at here in Augusta. The British commander at Augusta is Lieutenant Colonel Thomas Brown. Some of you may be familiar with him from the history. He is a provincial lieutenant colonel, though he's not a trained military man. He had been a plantation owner in Columbia County only for 3 years before the war broke out. So he had no military experience whatsoever. And he arrived here with 150 indentured servants in 1773 and set up a plantation out near Coyote Creek. And after he had been induced to try to join the Whig side in 1776, he decided not to do so, and he suffered physically for that, was beaten and so forth. But nevertheless, he's familiar with the area, and he has learned on the job, and he turns out to be a very, very good military leader, again, in spite of not having any sort of training for that. Now, he had been, during this time, before Green really arrives into the region in the early spring, Augusta is kind of under a loose siege by the Patriot militia. They're kind of harassing Brown. Brown is also going out, and they're having these minor skirmishes and so forth. And at a place called Fort Galphin at Silver Bluff on the Savannah River, it's on the South Carolina side, that was the trading post of one of the great Indian traders of the backcountry. And it really is like Walmart. If you go there today, it's like you walk around, it's like they just left the store. It is a tremendous place of trade. And so Brown had stationed a lot of his supplies there, to include the presents that he was given for the Indians, which he would trade with to get their cooperation. And Fort Galphin's about 12 to 15 miles south of Augusta. Now, Brown had stationed a company of his King's Rangers, commanded by Captain Samuel Rolworth, to guard the supplies. And in addition to that company, there were some elements of the New Jersey Volunteers, commanded by Captain Thomas Hanlock, and some Loyalist militia, along with some boatmen and so forth. So there were about 193 Loyalist troops at Fort Galphin. Brown wrote to the commander of the Savannah garrison, who was a Hessian, Colonel von Porbeck, and he asked for more men. He needed reinforcements, and von Porbeck said he could not spare a man, and so even though Governor James Wright urged him to send Brown troops, Brown did not receive any reinforcements, so he was on his own to protect Augusta. Now, when Lee arrives here, he and Pickens get together, and they decide to send elements of Lee's Legion along with some militia to capture Fort Galphin and the supplies, because there's a lot of good stuff there that they need. And so that is going to be the kind of the first event of this whole battle. So if next slide, please. And this is the site and kind of an artist's rendering from the archaeologists who've studied this place for many years. It's not entirely clear who commanded the Patriot force going against the British here. It's probably Major Rudolph, who was considered Lee's executive officer. But he did send an infantry, the infantry of his legion, and one troop of horse. They were detached for the march. This was also known as Fort Dreadnought, so sometimes you see references to that. In addition, Colonel Leroy Hammond had his regiment, except for one company, and Colonel William Hardin's regiment also participated. So Lee probably was not there, even though he writes about it in his memoirs, and it's a pretty good account. My impression is he was not there. This was Major Rudolph's job, because Lee's got other plans he's got to work out with Pickens at this time. So on the morning, a very hot, sultry morning, as you can imagine, in May, May 21st, Rudolph leads his force against this complex. Rudolph deployed his men in the pine trees that bordered around the fort. He ordered his militia infantry to dismount and to feign an attack against the position from the opposite direction of the main body of Legion infantry. He expected this diversion would draw Rolworth out of the fortified position, and then while he chased after the militia, then Rudolph would capture this site with his regular Continental infantry. He directed Hammond's and Hardin's militia units to guard the approaches around that area, so no reinforcements showed up to bother this operation. So when the feint attack begins, Rolworth does exactly what Rudolph had expected. They sally out of their position, they go to chase down the militia, and in the process, of course, they have to open the gates to the stockade, and that's when Rudolph leads the Legion infantry, who are some really tough guys, into this position. The Loyalists are quickly overwhelmed. They cease resistance. Casualties were rather minimal. The Whigs had one man die of heat stroke, which is not surprising given the weather, and about 8 or 10 wounded. The Loyalists lost 4 men killed, a few escaped, and they lost 187 men captured. So 187 men is a lot, given the fact that Brown feels he doesn't have enough men anyway. So it's a substantial number of people that Brown will not have here at Augusta. But the big prize was the capture of supplies. They captured gunpowder, lead balls, small arms, liquor, salt, blankets, all kinds of stuff that Greene and his army badly needed. And so the captures of these supplies provided a significant material enhancement to the militia who had been deprived of many of these items for so long. And so with the capture of Fort Galphin, now this sets the stage for the attack, the main attack here at Augusta. Next slide, please. So this chart here shows kind of the organization of the Patriot forces. It was kind of a dual command. Whenever you have the regular army and the militia together, the regular army commander is kind of the guy in charge, the militia kind of support, even though Pickens is a brigadier general. Henry Lee has the soldiers that are probably a little bit more trained, a little bit more disciplined as well. Lee brings with him, as I said before, 3 troops of cavalry, 4 companies of infantry, 3 of his own, plus a separate company under Lieutenant Manning. He has a small North Carolina regiment, really a battalion of regulars. These were called the one-year Continentals. They had been sentenced to service for 1 year in the Continental Army because they had previously been militia that ran away at Guilford Courthouse. So once they were recaptured, so to speak, by their own guys, they were sentenced to a 1 year of Continental service. And it was a good unit, though. It was very good. And then you had 1 6-pound cannon under the command of Captain Finley. This was from the Continental Artillery. So overall, Lee has about 468 men directly under his command. The other force, as you see, the other 1,000 men or so, is broken down between the Georgia and South Carolina militia. It's not really clear who had what. Generally, that's probably about the number. It probably would have split about 50-50 or so. But we do know the names of the commanders of the regiments: William Farr, William Hardin, Leroy Hammond for South Carolina, Colonel Williamson from Wilkes County, Colonel Baker from South Georgia down near near Savannah and Midway, Colonel Dunn from Burke County, and Shelby from Tennessee, not Isaac Shelby, his brother. Can't remember his name off the top of my head, but it's not Isaac Shelby. But there are some Mountaineers from Tennessee here that are kind of offered up to serve with the militia. Next slide, please. Now, the Loyalists under Thomas Brown numbered about 867 men. If you think about what he lost at Fort Galphin, he lost a substantial number, 187, I believe it was. He had his King's Rangers, who had been serving since 1776. They formed up in Florida. Many of them are South Carolinians and Georgians who had fled to Florida after being purged or so forth from South Carolina. He had a couple guns with him at Fort Cornwallis. The militia, the Georgia Loyalist militia, were led by Lieutenant Colonel James Grierson here at Augusta. He had a couple guns at Fort Grierson as well. There was a contingent of Indians. It's not quite sure what the number was. It's about 300 of Creeks, Cherokee, and Chickasaw. And then there were a number of slaves who were employed in keeping the fortifications in repair. A lot of earthwork involved in that. So that's what you have. You have about 1,500 Patriots versus about 900 Loyalists. So if you add that up, that's a pretty good sized battle, isn't it? Compared to some of the other battles we've looked at. Battle of Cowpens, just slightly less than what's at the Battle of Cowpens, really. So the next slide, please. So if you go around town here, you're gonna find a marker to Fort Grierson, which is in the wrong location, and it's inaccurate. No surprise there. One of the inaccuracies is that Colonel Richard Henry Lee was here. Well, now that's not him. Just Henry Lee. Richard Henry's another guy. And of course, as I said, it's in the wrong location. It also says that There's something else on there I don't recall. I'll show you where this thing is located in relationship to the actual fort. Next slide, please. So according to one of our local engineers and land surveyors, Tom Robertson, he did a study of the land plat, the plats of Augusta. And Grierson actually owned that plot number 10 that you see there. And those that had the river plots, of course, you know, everyone wants access to the water, right? Because that's where you bring your dock up. And so you kind of have that skinny, you know, everyone's got a skinny lot so that everybody gets a little bit of the shore to put your dock on. But you got that big, long kind of ribbon of land reaching back. And so that's kind of how that was. According to an eyewitness in 1779, actually Archibald Campbell described Fort Grierson as this. He said it was a stockade work with four bastions and eight small pieces of cannon. Now, this had changed by that time. But it was 60 yards west from the principal street, which is Broad Street. So if you were to figure that out today, and they were pretty good. I found out they're probably more accurate in measurement back then than we are today. From the information gathered from the eyewitnesses and extent maps and property records, Fort Grierson would have been located south of the 1200 block of Broad Street and north of Green Street between the present 12th and 13th Streets. Which puts it nowhere near the historical marker, which is over there off of Reynolds and 11th, which is a little bit, probably about a quarter mile away. Next slide, please. So this map shows the relationship of where Fort Cornwallis, which was built at St. Paul's Church, and the actual site of Fort Grierson, as I just described to you, and that little red dot, that little red star, shows where the historical marker is. So I don't know if you think that's close enough to the site or not. Well, there you have it. An important factor here is the distance between Fort Grierson and Fort Cornwallis. It's about a mile away. And given the ranges of their guns at the time, whether it's a smoothbore musket, 50 to 75 yards, a rifle, 200 yards, even a small cannon, you can't really support each other at that distance away. And that's going to be a key factor in their decision of how they're going to approach this. Now, Fort Cornwallis is built after Clark's failed attack here at Augusta. And in December of 1780, that's when Brown was told by Cornwallis, yeah, go ahead and build your fort. And so he organized the construction of a very substantial fortification there at the site of St. Paul's. And of course, he named it after Cornwallis. It was a very good fort. Earth is a great material for absorbing the impact of lead balls, whether those are cannonballs or lead shot. So it would have been a pretty tough place to take. As a matter of fact, Green is going to fail at 96, as we know, when they assault the Star Fort, which is also made of earth. And you just can't knock that stuff down. Next slide, please. So to orient you on the map here, Lee and Pickens decide to attack Fort Grierson first because it is a mile away from Fort Cornwallis. And what they're going to do is, this is their plan. The militia under Pickens and Clark will be the ones to attack Fort Grierson. Samuel Hammond is going to lead the attack. Every second man of that attacking force is going to carry an axe with them to cut through the palisades. The Georgia militia under Major James Jackson and the North Carolina Continentals, that small 115-man battalion under Major Pinkham Eaton, are going to assault from the east-hand side. And what Lee is going to do is he's going to hold Brown in check. He's going to deploy his infantry and cavalry in positions to where Brown cannot interfere with this thing. So let me just kind of point that out here on the map, I guess, over here. So Campbell's Gully runs in here, and it's a gully. If you've seen the gullies here along Broad Street, Hawk's Gully and so forth, they're pretty deep. And so you can hide in there. And so the idea is the Patriots under Eaton and Jackson will kind of move down this gully, then they'll pop out and then be on this side of the fort. Lee's infantry is going to do the same thing, but they're going to pop out on this side. His cavalry under Major Eggleston is going to be over here to prevent Brown from moving this way or that way, and so it kind of isolates this attack in one location. Does that make sense, everybody? So this is their plan, and it's actually a very good plan. Next slide, please. So the attack occurs in this sequence that you see here. Now, Grierson only had 80 men in this fort. The Americans were kind of coming at him with about 500. So it's really not much of going to be much of a fight. Grierson and his men realized immediately they were outnumbered. And so Grierson tries to break out from the fort, and they move towards the Savannah River. Brown tries to help them out. He brings his two cannon out from the fort, and he starts firing upon Lee's position over there along the gully. And Finley will return fire with the six-pound gun. So they kind of have an artillery duel. Nothing much really happens with that, but it is kind of a distracting thing. It does allow Grierson to escape, and eventually they make their way along the riverbank out of sight of the Patriots. And some of them make it to Fort Cornwallis, not a lot of them. The Loyalists, in this attempt to break out, had 30 men killed. And according to an eyewitness, they were strewn all over the area there between the fort and the Savannah River. 45 were wounded and 45 were made prisoners of war. The Patriots lost one killed. And who was that, you may ask? That was Major Pinkham Eaton, the commander of the North Carolina Continentals. And according to Lee, he said this about this battle. He said, "Our loss was trivial, a few wounded and fewer killed, but unhappily among the latter was Major Eaton of North Carolina, who had endeared himself to his commandant and fellow soldiers by the amiability of his manners. He fell gallantly at the head of his battalion in the moment of victory." And there's some debate about how he died. Some say he was taken a prisoner and executed. That's not what happened, according to the eyewitnesses. He probably suffered a grievous wound. He was bayoneted, and probably it cut a major vein, so he bled out very quickly. At least that's what I can determine from the sources. So Fort Grierson is now taken. It is no longer a threat, and now the next phase of the operation is going to take place. Next slide, please. Now, Lee had a lot of experience with siege operations. He and Marion had conducted a short siege at Fort Watson. The idea is you kind of take your time, you dig some trenches for protection, you try to bring artillery in, and then you try to reduce the fort. Well, you always ask the garrison to surrender first. That's always the best thing. He had also been involved at Fort Mott, which is another siege operation, and Fort Granby. So sieges is you know, he gets an A+ in those operations. And so much as he had done here, he directs that, again, because you have the riverbank there, it kind of gives you some protection. And so he has his forces dig trenches from the riverbank in. So I'm over here for the benefit of this side of the room.
Start reading here, and the trench will actually move in that direction. Okay. The borders will be on this side. Tartarian needs to be on that side in terms of the militia.
Now, they actually had a lot of tools. They had gotten a lot of tools from Fort Galphin, a lot of those trading items, picks and axes and shovels. And so they used the riverbank for cover. Lee suggested also building a mayhem tower, which was also another engine of war, kind of a Roman idea, where you build a tower tall enough so that you can fire down into a fort. And they had, again, done this at Fort Watson, Fort Mott, and Fort Granby. It was named after Colonel Hezekiah Mahan, who must have known his Roman history very well, because it's accredited to him, even though he would say, "Yeah, I just read a book about Caesar." But it was very effective, because if you could get some firepower above the walls of a fort, the fort's no good. If you can shoot inside the fort, you are literally shooting into the barrel. And so that's the idea. Now, in this case, the Mahan Tower has to be big enough to put the six-pounder cannon on. The six-pounder cannon is pretty big. Now, the way you build this thing is you build it kind of like Lincoln Logs. You know what I'm talking about? You take and you build a frame and you fill it with earth. And as you build up, you fill it with more earth, so it stabilizes it. So by the time you're done, you can put all kinds of weight on it. And there's probably going to be a ramp where you're going to haul your cannon up. I guess you could, you know, could winch it up. They knew how to do that too. But my impression from the description is there was a ramp that you used. So that was going to take some time to build. That's going to take several days, especially to get it in position. So before or until they can get that built, they're going to have to conduct some operations. Now, Thomas Brown is not just going to sit there and wait. He is going to try to break the siege. And Thomas Brown is going to be using every trick in the book that he has to try to break out. Brown, in the meantime, knows that this Mayhem Tower is coming at some point, so he has to improve his position as well. So he's going to increase the size of his walls using sandbags and, again, try to make it higher so that this tower they build is going to have to, you know, take longer to build. So it's really a good idea. The other thing that Brown supposedly does, and of course this is from the Patriots' side of the story, is that he places in key positions at the fort Whig prisoners that had been captured the previous year in Wilkes County. Many of these were the relatives of some of the militia here in the fight. Next slide, please. So on the night of the 28th of May, Thomas Brown decides, okay, I'm going to go out and I'm going to break up this this trench building operation. So he leads a company of the King's Rangers and some Indians from the fort, and they attack the militia in the trenches on the west flank near the river. So all this is kind of happening over on this side of the map. The attack was repulsed by a company of Lee's infantry commanded by Captain Samuel Handy. Now the fighting is hand-to-hand combat with bayonets in the trenches. And after this this incident, Lee decides, I'm going to have to put my infantry in the trenches at night because the militia don't have bayonets to fight with, just because they don't. And so Lee says this about this fight. He says, on the 28th, he, Brown, fell upon our works in the river quarter at midnight, and by the suddenness and vigor of his onset, drove the guard before him. But the support under Captain Handy, coming up after an obstinate conflict, regained the trenches and forced the enemy to take shelter in the fort. So they have this brutal hand-to-hand combat in the middle of the night on the 28th of May. Next slide, please. So the next night, on the 29th of May, Brown's going to do it again. He's going to lead another attack on those same trenches. And again, fierce hand-to-hand combat is going to ensue. This time, it's Captain Michael Rudolph's infantry that is going to be the main player. And they, too, will be involved in the bayonet fighting that occurs amongst the Loyalists and the Patriots. The Rangers do suffer some losses. We're not quite sure what those are. So Brown tries that again, push back into the fort. Next slide, please. On the night of May 30th, Brown does it again. He's not going to give up. He's just not going to sit there and let these guys build a trench. And so this time, however, he pretty much puts everything in. He goes all in. He pretty much takes everybody he has, and he attacks both trench works at the same time. He knew the Mayhem Tower was close to being built, and as soon as that thing gets built, it's pretty much game over. So the west trenches were manned by Pickens' militia and Handy's infantry company, along with now Captain Smith's battalion of North Carolina Continentals after Eaton's death. And the east trenches were held by Clark and his militia, along with Rudolph's company of infantry. Brown used the elite of his troops, and about 10 o'clock, he attacked both of these trench works. And he successfully pushed the Georgia militia out of the trenches using his bayonets until Rudolph pushed them back the other way. Brown attacked Pickens' men with the rest of his force, but Handy also assaulted with the bayonet and drove the Loyalists back. Based on the ferocity of the fighting that occurred this night in these confined trench areas, this is probably where the majority of the casualties of this battle occurred. There's not really a good account of who lost who at this night. But there's really nowhere else you would have had those type of casualties. Next slide, please. So this is what the main tower may have looked like. Now, back in 2006, if any of you were here, the reenactors really wanted to build a main tower, which to me, this has got liability written all over it from an insurance perspective. I couldn't believe it was done. I don't know how that happened, and nobody got hurt, so of course that never came up. But it was engineered well. I mean, this was not your Revolutionary War man tower. I mean, engineers, I mean, they dug the holes, they put the posts in, I think they put cement in. I mean, this thing was pretty sturdy, okay? And then they used a pulley system to get the cannon up there. But that's about what it would have looked like. And so it would have taken some time, and I think it took them all twice as long to build this in 2006 than it did the one in the Revolution. But that's okay, we had to make sure it was safe. So this is what it would have looked like. And again, once that tower gets built and you can look into the fort, you know, you can hit anything inside that fort. The walls have disappeared now. You don't have to worry about the walls. Next slide, please. So one of the things that is going to happen, once they get this main tower built, they'll put the six-pounder up there and they will start firing at one part of the fort, and if you keep hitting it over and over and over again, the enemy's not going to be able to repair it. You're going to eventually kind of wear a hole in the earthwork, and so the idea is to kind of focus on this one area, pound it to death, and then the next morning, the idea is you're going to attack with your infantry and go through that hole. Again, not a bad plan. Now, there was still actually a house kind of standing out there between the Americans and the British, and so during the day, Brown observed that some of Pickens' militiamen had occupied that house. It looks like they were going to use it as a sniper position where they could kind of fire and pick off some of the folks in Fort Cornwallis. And Brown, of course, isn't going to let that happen. So what he orders his men to do is dig a trench out to that house, and they place gunpowder in it. And the idea is when the Americans take that, you know, are in that position, they would blow it up and he'd kill the Americans. Well, they don't really do that. Pickens decides he doesn't really need to do that, so he doesn't put anybody in that house. But Brown doesn't know that. According to Lee, at 3 o'clock in the morning, a huge explosion shakes the entire area. And Brown had blown up this house with this gunpowder. According to Lee, this is what Henry Lee says, he said it was severed and thrown into the air 30 or 40 feet high, its fragments falling all over the field. So, again, Brown is trying every trick in the book to, you know, really make it tough on the Patriots to capture Fort Cornwallis. And he really did. Now, the next morning, I should say this, throughout the siege, Pickens and Lee had sent in several requests for Brown to surrender, and Brown said, no, I'm not going to do it. The day before, on the 4th of June, they had asked Brown to surrender. He said, no, that's King George's birthday. I can't do that. I'll wait till the next day. And so that's kind of how he approaches this thing. The interesting thing is, too, Brown would only talk to Pickens and Lee. He would not talk to Elijah Clark. He didn't recognize him. He recognized Lee as his counterpart in the Continental Army. They were of the same class in society, planters, so they kind of saw each other as equals. But he didn't view Elijah Clark that way. So at 9 o'clock in the morning on the 5th of June, the Patriots start to assemble their assault force. And about this time is when Brown says, okay, there's nothing more I can do. You got this tower. You got more men than I do. It ain't no sense. There's no sense, you know, fighting to the death. And so Brown agrees to surrender. Next slide, please. This painting that's in the Augusta Museum of History kind of shows what it looked like from the Loyalist perspective. You can kind of see from inside the fort there, it's made of earth. They've got their two cannon there on those positions. And in the background, you see that main tower. Kind of looks like the picture I just showed you, right? So, yeah, it was pretty accurate. So he accepts Lee and Pickens' surrender offer. Now, Thomas Brown was allowed to surrender inside the fort. He never left the fort. And he was then escorted to Lee's quarters by a very heavy guard to protect him from the Georgia militia. Lee wrote this about Thomas Brown. He said, "This precaution was indispensable. Lieutenant Colonel Brown's life was, we knew, sought with avidity. Consequently, it became our duty to secure his person before the garrison marched out. The laurels acquired by the arms of America would have been stained by the murder of this gallant soldier." So you can kind of see that just read, you know, this guy's, we're the same class, you know, that sort of thing. Now, James Grierson, the Georgia militia loyalist, weren't afforded that same criteria. The militia were not seen as you know, as being worthy of that. So he's just sent back to his house to be watched by a light guard. Lee, meanwhile, is getting ready on June 6th to get to 96. He now has to, you know, Augusta's been captured. Pickens is going to be in charge of this place to kind of gather things up, get up all the supplies. Once he gathers up all the supplies and everything, then he will eventually make his way to 96 as well. But Lee's got to get going. And so Lee, pretty much once he's done with the surrender, he focuses on getting his troops ready and getting ready to march out the next day. So he's not really concerned with what's going to happen here. He's going to let Pickens deal with that. Next slide, please. So eventually, Thomas Brown and the other provincial officers, actually provincial soldiers, will be sent to Savannah on parole. But they got to get to Savannah first. And one of Lee's units, I think it's actually the North Carolina company, escorts Brown and the Loyalists to Savannah, and they said this was the most dangerous mission they ever had during the war, was to protect the Loyalists as they got them down to Savannah and turned them loose on parole. So he heads down there. Pickens is now in charge of this place. Lee is going off to 96. And this is when the murder of James Grierson occurs. And on the 6th of June, two couriers probably passed each other on Martintown Road between Augusta and 96. The messenger from 96 carried a letter from Green to Elijah Clark, and it was written on the 7th of June. Now, that letter didn't arrive until the 9th of June, a few days later. Green told Clark this, quote, "The high reputation you have induces me to address myself to you and to use your influence to restrain two very capital evils which rage in the country and which, if not prevented, must soon be populated. I mean private murders and plundering. Let me entreat you to exert yourself as much as possible to stop the progress of this business." So that's the letter Green was sending to Augusta and to Elijah Clark. Meanwhile, there was a letter traveling the other way to Green, and that letter was from Pickens, who had to inform Green of a situation that had occurred at Augusta. And that situation was this. According to Pickens, in his letter to Green, he said, quote, "A very disagreeable and melancholy affair, which happened yesterday in the afternoon, occasions my writing to you at this time. I had ridden down to Brown's Fort, where I had been but a few minutes, when information was brought to me that a man had ridden up to the door of a room here where Colonel Grierson was confined, and without dismounting, shot him so that he expired soon after. I have given orders for burying Colonel Grierson this afternoon with military honors." Now, Samuel Beckham, who's a kind of a famous pensioner of this time, identifies Captain James Alexander of Wilkes County as the man who called Grierson to the door under the pretense of speaking with him. Alexander's father had been one of the elderly hostages taken from Wilkes County to Augusta during the punitive raid back in September of 1780. Grierson went to the door, and he met Alexander, who, quote, "saluted him with a rifle ball, which killed him. Grierson was then stripped of his clothes, his naked body mutilated, and then thrown into the ditch outside his house." Grierson was 40 years old when he was killed, and he had lived pretty much most of his life here in Augusta, Georgia. He left behind three children. They were also there at that time. Green was furious about this episode, calling it an insult to the arms of the United States, as well as an outrage committed upon the rights of humanity, deserves the most exemplary punishment. Now, Green was concerned that Grierson's murder might be used to justify retaliatory acts by the British. Governor James Wright wrote to Colonel Nesbitt Balfour, the British commandant at Charleston, quote, poor Grierson was basely murdered after the capitulation and laying down his arms. It is hoped that this worthy man's death will not pass without due notice. Colonel Balfour will later invoke Grierson's name when Greene protests the hanging of Isaac Hayne at Charleston later that year. So much as Greene had predicted, this thing is going to become one of those back and forth type things. Next slide, please. At the end of the battle, the casualties for the Loyalists, the Loyalists lost 82 killed and 379 were prisoners of war. The Whigs lost about 26 to 28 killed and 38 to 40 wounded. So overall, the total deaths in this battle of both sides, when you add them up, 108 to 110 men were killed in the Second Battle of Augusta, which is, again, a pretty significant number for a Revolutionary War battle. And of course, the dead included Major Pinkham Eaton, who was from a rather prominent family of North Carolina. So in short, that is kind of the story of the actual Battle of Augusta and how it came about and how it proceeded and the locations of where you may still kind of, I guess, visit today in Augusta. Thank you. Does anybody have any questions? Yes, sir.
Yeah,
Reverend Smith, will you come up, please? Fellow compatriots, please stand and join me in reciting the SAR processional. Until we meet again, let us remember our obligations to our forefathers, who gave us our Constitution, the Bill of Rights, an independent Supreme Court, and a nation of free men. Alan, if you will give us our benediction.
O gracious God, we give you thanks for these brave men from both sides who laid down their lives. For those who fought for independence, we give you thanks. May we ever live up to their example. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, amen.
Thank you, sir. Please remain standing. Color Guard and Commander, retrieve the colors.
Color Guard, attention, hut, forward, march.
We're going to follow the color guard out to the battlefield behind the center. And if you don't mind, give them just about 5 or 10 minutes to clear and get set up. Thank you for filming. We appreciate you having you.